Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paulistic Behind the Curtain. Ordinarily, I open by saying it's my opportunity to leave the world of politics and law behind from the WGN-TV world and talk about the world of theater and the arts. Except this time, actually, I don't quite do that. We are talking about the world of theater and the arts, but we're doing so with a focus on the law and politics, because you can't help it when the show you're talking about is What the Constitution Means to Me, currently playing over at the Timeline Theater on Wellington. And what an amazing show it is. I saw it in its other form with Broadway in Chicago, and now it's back in a very intimate setting, which, as you will see with our guests, a set that I think is even more amazing than one I've seen before. Let me introduce my guest to you. First of all, playing the lead, playing Heidi, playing the person who technically wrote this thing, is Beth Lackey, who has, and I got to talk to you about that, Beth, because yes, you see a lot of people. And also the director of the show, because, you know, Beth and I can kind of make some guesses at things, but that Helen Young can step in and say, no, let me tell you what is really going on here. And that is good. And just so you know, Beth, we're paying homage to you, because Helen, you are perfectly placed. But take a moment and show Beth what you're really covering up.
What? Oh,
it's you, Beth. It's you.
Oh, my God. Oh, my favorite. It's just me.
So it's you're here and yet you're there.
The power of magic of theater and film and computers. And thank you, Helen, for staying exactly dead center in the frame. Yep. Thank you,
Helen. But you need to know, if the pandemic comes back, we're shifting to that other set. So that's, you know,
perfect.
No, God forbid, that'll never happen. So Beth, I said you trick people, and the reason for that is because you play Heidi Schreck, but she's not just a character. She's the one who tells the story, but she is the playwright, and this is her life. And I can't tell you how many people, with all due respect, not only in this incarnation, yes, but in previous incarnations, no matter who's in that role, they think they're going, no, we actually had the playwright. Right. How do you feel about that, knowing that that's what it means you're successful in what you're doing?
Oh, you mean that people mistakenly think that I'm the one who
they just think
it?
You're really Heidi. Yeah, that you wrote this thing.
Then mission accomplished. That just means that I've, not that I've fooled people, but that in our storytelling, through Helen's direction and what we've all created together, that it feels very personal, and that by embodying the story as much as possible, that people will believe that's the goal of any play, of any, you know, narrative and any storytelling, is you want it to be as personal as possible, and people will believe. But I had a lot of panics before Helen and I really started working together. She was getting like 3 emails a day. Like, I mean, should I watch it? Should I watch it on Amazon? Should I not watch it? Should, you know, because I really didn't want to, it would be a fool's errand to try and channel Heidi's performance, because no one can be Heidi. So I wanted to be a channel for her story and less her, which is a tricky thing, because I also wanted to respect the fact that it is her story. So it was a fine line to walk. And thankfully I had Helen Young is my navigator of that.
I'm going to come back to you in a moment and ask about the play. But given what you said, I want to do a quick follow up with that, sure, with our director, Helen Young, because, you know, Helen, unlike doing a show about Tina Turner or Michael Jackson, where you have the audience going, OK, I know who that person is, so let's see how good the actor is. And even different from doing a show like Dear Evan Hansen, where you say, I know Ben Platt, so let's see if the rest of these folks can do it. Here, while you did originally on Broadway have the playwright do the performance, but Heidi is not that well known of a figure where you can have an actor step in and pull off portrayal. But I'm curious, as the director, did you sort of want this to be true? Because you have seen, I'm sure, Heidi's performance. So did you say, we got to be true to Heidi? Or did you say, no, I'm directing Beth now. This is our own thing.
Yeah, the latter. Yeah, the latter. Okay. And so the reason is, I think the play, I don't know if I'm the one that's causing the feedback. Sorry about that. I think this play works best when it's very personal. So one of the things that Beth and I talked about was making it as personal as possible, but being true to the various arcs of the story. And Beth did such an amazing job that her friends, who she's known for, you know, over I don't know how many years, said to me at some point, we thought, are these Beth's stories that got added to Heidi's play? So to me, mission accomplished. So
yeah. Oh, absolutely. So Beth, I want you to tell the story of what this is about, but here's the good news. You can use the set that's behind Helen to tell the story of what we're going to see, because fortunately, that's the set. And I'm going to compliment that. I don't know who designed that set, but Helen, I got to tell you, I've seen this show before. I have never seen as good a set to get the message across for this show. I mean, you know, people do different things. I know we're in a Legionnaire Hall and all of that. I don't ever recall seeing anything that's like, you really feel like you're in a Legionnaire's Hall. So Beth, tell us the story, but feel free to make reference to the set that happens to be in the picture.
Thank you. Well, it's actually interesting because to your point, different iterations of this, it has been probably more of a symbolic kind of set. And so there's a line in the play where Heidi says, this hall, it's not a naturalistic representation of an American Legion Hall. And like every night when I say that, I'm a little bit like, It's as messy as you can get. This is pretty like, you know, plus like the intimacy of the space, you really do feel like you're walking in. So basically what the Constitution means to me is a play from a woman's perspective who, Heidi Schreck, who when she was 15 years old, she would perform speeches about the Constitution at American Legion Halls for these contests where she would earn prize money to put herself through college, which she was so good at in real life at 15 that she was able to save up enough money to completely pay for her state school 30 years ago, but she was able to pay for it. That's how much of an expert she was at 15 on the Constitution. She really, really, really loved it. She was a zealot. She was very passionate about the Constitution. But then in her 40s, she started to revisit the Constitution based on the political landscape that was happening in our country. And really starting to question what was it that I loved about the Constitution. And so she thought she would revisit those old speeches in with her current middle-aged, I've lived through life. I have a different, you know, perspective just on what America means, what America means to marginalized communities, what America means to women, and also her family's stories. And really incorporating that, I think, in a very brave way to personalize these concepts, these ideas about how the Constitution may or may not fail certain groups. And then by bringing in her actual family, her actual own personal experience, inviting the audience to think about their own families, about their own experience, and really kind of making the Constitution a living, breathing document. And hopefully by the end, you're re-inspired to find ways that the Constitution can work for us. And to really, I think it's a very patriotic play. I think it's, you know, very supportive of the democratic process, really trying to show people that you have to get involved. So it's a bit of a love letter to the Constitution while also be like, do I want to break up with you? I don't know. You know, you've hurt me. You've hurt me terribly, but I love you. You know, it's kind of that emotionally abusive relationship with the Constitution. So Helen, I'll give it over to you.
I'm going to just follow up with Helen on that. With Helen, if I can, first of all, I have to say, I'm a geek about this stuff because as I mentioned, I was a law school dean and my world lives in all this and I've been teaching constitutional law for 20 years. So when I go and sit down in that show, I'm ready to take notes going, I'll tell you what you got right, which is not smart. But I also make an assumption. One quick follow-up for you, Beth. I got to get to Helen. But sure. One quick follow-up for you. I assume that because you're doing this role, you too have become a Constitution geek and that you and I could sit over a cup of coffee and just talk about the Constitution. Do you care or are you an actor? So I do. It's a role.
No. I do care. But if I say this, please don't ask me any questions. But I actually, like because I got the part back in December, but as soon as the new year rolled around, I actually put up a post on my social media, like with a huge stack of Constitution, you know, books on the Constitution saying, do not disturb. Like I actually had it on a mug. I'm like, do not disturb. Like not only do I have to memorize a lot of words, but I'm going to try and, you know, shove as much because Heidi, to her point, was, you know, a bit of an expert. I mean, she earned a lot of money at 15. So I wanted to not just honor the personal stories, but her knowledge. But yes, I'd like to In my imagination, yes, I too could sit with you over a cup of coffee and speak to the Constitution, but not in any way that one of your students would want to be quizzed. So yes.
Oh, no, I won't even go there. I think we'd have a more interesting conversation. And Helen, here's my follow-up with you. And my first question to you, there's one rule. You do not get to answer this with the answer both. Is this play the story about Heidi Schreck and her life, career, growing up, all that kind of stuff? Or is it about the Constitution and what it needs to mean to the country? And I know the answer is both, but if I don't let you say both, which way?
Helen, you choose one and I'll say the other. that's how we divide and conquer, Helen, divide and conquer.
It is about the Constitution and what we who hear about this situation need to do something about this country, whichever side we feel we're part of, or not even two sides, the hundreds of sides we may have in this country. We need to exercise our democracy and figure out how the Constitution does and does not protect us or argue for our rights, and then do something about it.
All right, fair enough. Beth, I have to ask you, in my world, I'm just stopped on the street all the time, whatever, with people who then want me to hear their view of politics and, you know, what they think about everything. And I smile and whatever, when in my head I'm going, I don't really want to listen to this. But so I'm sort of curious, after the show, I'm sure people are waiting for you. Aside from those who say, I love you, you're fabulous and whatever, do you have people who then do want to engage in to let you know what they think about things and, you know, what's right?
Yes, I have. Because I'm spending so much time in an intimate space with the audience, and there are a few times I'm really maintaining eye contact for an incredibly long period of time, I'm sure, for the audience member. So there is a kind of a personal connection, which those of us who are involved in the play, we keep wondering what it would be like in Lincoln Center, where she was, like where it would be in these large, you know, spaces, because we just love our 99 seat house. I can see every single face in the crowd. So I think just by the very nature of the play, there already feels to be a conversation that's been started between myself and the audience members. And in the second half of the debate, we're also asking them for their voice to be shared. So I think it's already set. So yes, after the show, it's been kind of an extension of that conversation. And although a few times, even in the debate where we, you know, give the microphone to someone, and we just say, this is all you have to do is read it out loud. We've had on more than one occasion people using that as a platform for their views. Before we're like, could you open the envelope? So they have like a good, you know, but what's also fascinating to me, and it could just be the nature of the play, it's mostly women. It's mostly women who have an opinion. And most of the opinions are actually, because they somewhere are a little bit older, are to please get involved. You know, so when they have that microphone, they're saying, even from a place of it was actually much harder for me than for you. Yeah. And they're saying, don't let that discourage you. Don't let that set a depression in, or it's outside of my control, you know. So it's been very empowering. And there have been more than one occasion where we have an evening show. It's usually after the matinee, where there are people out, where Raymond Fox, who's always, you know, he's always my best buddy. He plays the Legionnaire. He's always like, okay, Beth needs to eat. Like, let's go, you know, we have another show to do. But I personally love talking about it. And what's also really beautiful is they're not just talking about the Constitution. They're talking about things that happened to them in their own lives, and things that happened to their mothers and grandmothers. And so to me, it's a great honor to hear those stories. And that's a testament to this play, is that people who are listening or participating are thinking about their own stories and their families. So
yeah, I think the first time this play made its rounds was on Broadway. It was all pre-pandemic, but it was also before the court had its current look. And so there's no doubt in my mind with the abortion issues, the gun issues, the things that are, and just wait, folks, you are on, this show runs through it as we talk now through July 2nd. And the last week of June is when all the big cases come down from the Supreme Court, including affirmative action and other cases, which I can tell you what's probably going to happen. But let me tell you, you'll have even more audience members getting ready to chat with you. Mm-hmm. After our last week in June. But that being said, by the way, Raymond Fox scares the hell out of me, because Ever since I saw him perform at Looking Glass a while, but I want to say the show was, you know, and where he played the stalker, the pedophile stalker. And I mean, I saw him at the party afterwards, opening night, whatever. And I went, I swear, I mean, you just scared the hell out of me. And he's a great guy, you know, and I had to talk to Schwimmer, other people who are like, no, he's fine.
He said that one, he spoke to that, like, because doesn't he start in the audience too?
With that show? I can't remember that so many. Oh, he might. Yeah.
I think he starts in the audience, like he's like sitting next to you the entire time, and then like the creepy guy, and he's the exact opposite. So that's a testament to his ability to completely transform and
absolutely take on and characters. Also a testament to his ability, the fact that years later he's still scaring the hell out of me. I see him on stage and I'm like, oh no, who's he looking at? Anyway, my compliments to him. Tell him I said.
Yes, we will.
So Helen, I did another follow-up question with you, and I imagine you will know the answer to this, and maybe I'm wrong. I saw this play in its previous incarnation, whatever. I also know that I think we're very early on. I think the reason you guys are able to present this is because the rights are now being released. And so we're now, you know, beyond the Broadway moment. And I thought I heard some changes in the script, nothing major, but a few moments here and there. And I thought that's been updated. That's been modified. And I thought that could only happen because it perhaps has been released and Heidi allowed that to happen. Am I nuts about this? What's the deal?
No, we have the latest version, which was copyright 2022. And I think her original version was 2018 or 19. So we do have an updated version. And in her script, there are encouragements for ad-lib as needed. So some things are ad-libbed in the moment based on what's happening in the room, but not a lot. But it is an updated script for sure.
Okay, so I wasn't wrong about that. That's good. And Beth, let me come back to you, because in this, I'm trying not to never have secrets come from me. I don't want to disclose something and have you say, you know, I wish you hadn't said that. So I let you do all the disclosing. Although I have to tell you.
Let it fall on me. Yes.
Well, it's like when I interviewed the cast of Dear Evan Hansen, they didn't want people to know that Connor died in the first 7 seconds. I'm like, that's the, anyway, like I'm not ruining anything.
Right.
But anyway, so in this show, the second part of it, we get to meet Sophie, and is it Michaela? Am I saying?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we get to meet Sophie or Michaela, depending on the night that we're there. And that's something that, talk about who those actors are. And I also think, I'll come back to Helen for this, but there might be a change too. I'm feeling like maybe that we're getting actors performing. I felt like when I saw it years ago, I'm not sure, but I think I was just seeing actual debaters who were not winging it, but it was. So Beth, what are we seeing in the second part of that show without me giving things away?
Well, Helen might speak to previous productions. I know that Heidi did work with an actual debater that she pulled out of a New York school. So the original was the debater. And I believe that debater did tour, start the tour with the first actor who took on the role. So I'll set up the debate, and then I'm going to go over to Helen to talk about Michaela and Sophie and that process of casting and what Helen was looking for in that debater as it's changed. But the second part, the first part, while being very light, and Helen and I were laughing that she'll send friends and they'll come, she's like, wasn't that so much fun? And they're like, what do you mean fun? And I was like, yeah, but it's funny, you know? So the first half has some lightness and there's all, but it does, we go through a lot as a collective, you know, Raymond and I, you know, Heidi and Danny on the show, you know, in the play, we kind of go through a lot and we're dealing with really big topics about the Constitution, whether or not it's working or if it's doing the exact thing that it was designed to do from the beginning, and can it shape and shift, and how it has through amendments and throughout history. And that progress kind of goes back and forth. So the second part of the show is a debate that is a live debate that is fresh, you know, every night within the framework as well. So I always say that there are things that Heidi wanted to continue to say in the debate.
Do the topics change?
Well, yes and no. So Heidi has, I think there's like a framework, and that's one of the areas where Helen said, you know, in the play, it says, feel free to ad lib, and that, you know, if there's current things going on, or, you know, we've taken a lot with the audience, but there are certain ideas and concepts that I think when Heidi was, I'm assuming that when Heidi was playing it herself, it could have been fully improvised because they were her thoughts and ideas. But as she's now let us all kind of take it and run, those thoughts and ideas still needed to be conveyed. And so it's through the debate, but there is a lot of fun. So per night, Sophie and Michaela, we switch off and we switch off different, whether we keep or abolish the Constitution. That is the debate. I should have started with that. So the debate is, do we keep the Constitution or do we abolish it? And then we have fun with that. Helen, if you want to speak to about Sophie and Michaela and.
Yeah, I mean, it is scripted. The debate is scripted. So, and there are clearly, as Beth mentioned, there are topics or ideas or phrasings of sentences that Heidi wanted us to share. So in that sense, it's not a spontaneous debate, if that's the question.
And by the way, with all due respect, it makes total sense because in the original iteration of this, when if Heidi actually had a debater on there, you could do what she was doing. But now this thing is for public release. And so, yes. You know, you can't expect theater companies all over whoever does this. I don't know of anybody else doing it besides Timeline, but that's all I care about.
thank you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you shouldn't have to like, you know, send a message out to all the local universities that we need a debater. That would put pressure on you, I think, as a director, Helen, that just who needs that?
Yeah, and it would put a lot of pressure on the actors each night too, yeah, to say, okay, what are we doing tonight? You know, so it's helpful that it's scripted. Thank
yeah,
God.
Plus because Beth is playing an expert in these debates. Maybe you were, Beth, I don't know, in your past, but we can't expect every actor to be the expert debater.
No, you certainly can't expect that from me. I don't know about the other, for me, 100% no. The joking around and the playing and all of that, oh, here comes my dog who doesn't like.
Oh,
my,
dogs are mine.
He doesn't like, my Zoom voice. He always wants to know if he needs to call the fire department. He always thinks I'm under duress. Yes, the fun that I have with the debater and the fun I have with the audience, that is something that I could, you know, I could do all day and all night and really, you know, get people excited and jazzed. But no, the actual points made. Although Ruth Bader Ginsburg's son, who came to the show last week, he had some suggestions that I don't know if you got the note through Miranda, Helen. There was just one and that I have added it, which is Michaela asks, so now, right now is when you want to change the Constitution. I just say, well, not while Marjorie Taylor Greene is in office. No. And it gets a huge, like, no. So he just wanted her name in there for, like, he's like, it was just an idea. He's like, because that also brings in the reality that wasn't even there when Heidi, when 2000. So the last, I'm so sorry, Helen, we have the updated script from what year?
2022.
Right. Mm-hmm. 2022. Mm-hmm. So, but there's even our current, you know, political climate is even more dangerous than it was when this was first written, and the different, you know, amendments, as you will say, to the play since.
Well, and by the way, Beth, to what extent you have your own political views, I'm not asking you about that. I got to deal with that in my show, but to the extent that your politics gets triggered one way or the other, uh-huh, in this thing, that has to also influence, well, you're an actor, so maybe it doesn't influence your performance, but I would influence my performance.
It does, you know, Helen created an environment in our rehearsal process where, you know, that whole first week really only had about 3 weeks of rehearsal before, I think, previews, if that's correct. So, and she allowed, I'm speaking views if you're not here, Helen.
Let's talk about her.
Yeah, let's talk about Helen. So anyway, she's really amazing. So she allowed like a full week of table work where we were just talking about the play. And in that space, even, this is completely a testament to Helen, that we all got to talk about our personal experiences. And this even includes like we had an interim stage manager because our other one was working another show. So we had a woman who was there for a week who was sharing her perspectives and her, you know, stories. So as actors, you kind of take from everywhere. So everyone was offering me things. It was like bunches of flowers, right? And all of a sudden I have this huge thing of flowers. So the whole play is, you know, this person's story and that person's grandmother. And then my own political views. And Helen, one of the things that we did talk about a lot is I come from a very Catholic family. And they have very strong pro-life views. So my approach to that one section of the play was important to me that all of these things I've heard about women, this assumption about women who, and I don't want to give too much weight for your audience, but for women who are making reproductive choices, that there's a perception based on what I've just heard for, you know, since I could hear the story, so 30 years, that was important to me, which may or may not be true of other actors' performances in that section. It might be more strident for different actors, but for me, I wanted to convey that it is a difficult decision, no matter what you do, whatever you choose, because it was important for me, which is part politics, part family, part, you know, how I, it's very tricky too. You never want to emotionally manipulate an audience. And this is a fine line with this play because there are so many emotions and there are so many, so in bringing heart and bringing my own personal experience to this play, I just wanted to kind of lay it out there. So yeah, so my politics, my upbringing, my family's politics, their upbringing, you know, there's a lot about lineage in this play too. And we're all kind of, the end of a very long story until our children. So all of the different interweavings of families and stories and perspectives kind of are being channeled through me, through Heidi's story. So yes, my politics are there, and it's very exciting because I get to hide behind Heidi. Like, as was it great as a middle-aged woman? I'm like, finally, I can tell everyone that I'm pro-choice, you know, and I do it through Heidi and through Heidi's story. So yes, my politics are there. My family's politics are there. Audience's politics are there. Everyone, it is really a communal experience more than I've ever had, including the rehearsal process.
And I'm going to come to Helen, but I just have to ask you, Beth, did you know that James Ginsberg was in the audience before the show?
No, they did not tell us. And then all of a sudden we come around the corner, like, hey, that was a pretty, okay. You know, we always do the, oh, that was a terrible show, or that was a wonderful show, or, you know, oh, I made a mistake, or I stumbled over the word Herbert Hoover, which is always hard for me to say every night, you know, like, how did I do on Herbert Hoover? Fair to Midland. And then all of a sudden they're like, quickly get out of your clothes. We're like, wait, what? They're like, get out of your costume. Got a very special guest. And then whenever they have a special guest, they always have to say, it's not Heidi. That's always the first thing. It's not Heidi, but we have a very special guest. And when they know, so I did not know that Jim and Abby, and then Jim also brought me a gift. He brought me an album of his wife's, like, it's called A Song Cycle.
Yeah, you posted. I saw a picture you posted.
Yes.
I saw that.
So it was a gift of, you know, songs about his mother. And yeah, it was very powerful. Yes. Okay.
How neat. Yeah, because you know what? If I were like your role and I knew he was there, I would probably at some point look at him and just go, wait, Jim, didn't your mom say that, you know?
I would have, with the voiceover at the end, I just would have made direct eye contact with him, just let the tears. Your mom's exactly. Voice, she's, you know, we all feel her, you know, so yeah.
Right. Helen, so as director, again, I'm not asking you for your politics, but as director, you can't help but have it. So did you work with Beth, the other, you know, Raymond, the other actors in the show? Is there some sort of kumbaya, let's have a discussion before we get into this and put that kind of stuff on the table? Or is it irrelevant to your role as a director to say, I don't care how you think, we got a show to put on?
No, we talked about it a lot, but there's also the element of things that I wanted to make sure that we shared that we also brought to the table. But the rehearsal process that I love is to hear everyone's viewpoint. And then in the end, you know, trust that if I had to make a hard choice, I will make the choice that's needed to get to where we need to go. So we don't have a mishmash of a story. But I will say what's amazing about both Beth and Raymond is they are both people who can take in a lot of different viewpoints and then merge it together in something complex. So I am so thrilled that I got to work with both of them and so grateful that they can do that. So.
Yeah. And by the way, Helen, there's something, again, I don't give up anything. So the audience members leave with a little gift. And I'm guessing, because I can also remember getting those at past shows, is that a requirement or is that a timeline thing saying we're going to do that too?
It's written in the script to give those away. But I don't think it's required. It's not legally required. We were able to acquire those from the original production because they are not touring. And so And they were kind enough to share those with us. So.
Okay. And now folks watching and listening, what is he talking about? Well, you have to go see the show to find out. That's
clever.
The whole point.
Clever.
And Beth, I mean, you've got such an extensive, I mean, you've been at Steppenwolf and Goodman and, you know, I mean, just all the great theaters around Chicago and elsewhere, but Timeline, I've always found, first of all, love your current location. I know you're moving to a better one, and I'm always telling PJ, don't move because I walk there. So, no parking problems, and it's all about me. So I really don't, that's all that matters to me. But anyway, talk to me about what's different. I just think Timeline gets a bit of a different, Chicago audiences are all great, but Timeline seems to get a bit of a more sophisticated audience, maybe because of the love of history.
I, you know, so this is my third production with Timeline, and I actually went to DePaul with the founding members. So I've known PJ and Nick and Juliet and Pat, like I've known them since, you know, we were kids.
And yet they're all so much older than you, but go ahead.
They're so much older. And I'm like, this is weird, you guys. I don't remember being 12 in college, but I was pretty advanced. What they started with, so I remember their mission and their passion in the beginning. And I joke with them that we all were like, they just decided to create this theater company right out of college. And we were like, you're crazy. And they had this passion and this mission that they have successfully, season after season, have gone deeper and broader and deeper and broader. It's like simultaneous, you know, and with that brought in more and more audiences. So I think they have one of the highest subscriber rates in the city. And I think that's a testament to how audiences can count on them. You know, production after production after production, you can count on them for either it's the story, either it's the performances, either it's the set, it's like all of the different components. They just care so passionately about what they're doing. And they care so passionately about the stories that they are trying to tell. And I think that does read. And to your point, I love that 99C house. You know, there's nothing like them. And to me, that's what makes Chicago special. I mean, I'm sure their next space is going to be amazing and beautiful. And then that will afford them to reach even more audiences, which is, you know, great. But yes, that's my experience with them. And this is Helen's second production with them, right? Helen, I don't know if you can speak to them.
Yeah, I did. Although I have to tell you, on Fridays, the good thing about being where you are, you're also attached to the Chabad Lakeview, which is a synagogue. And so on Friday nights, I'll pop by late afternoon because you can get challahs made by the rabbi's wife and just take them in before your performance and sit and eat a nice warm loaf of bread.
So is that what's set up outside?
Yeah, His kids are selling chocolate chip cookies, often lemonade, weather's getting good again, and challahs. And I would like to recommend of the three kinds, there's the regular, and I grew up with this, there's the regular and the sweet and this and the everything bagel type.
Okay.
It's, you know, the everything is really good. And in fact, I do our 9 o'clock news at night. I do a political weekend review, and it's gotten to the point where I now have to bring everybody rolls or pieces of a loaf. And so there's Tom Skilling munching on a piece of challah bread. But it's really good. And it's on Friday. So that's what that's all
Thank
about.
You very much. I'll take a picture of me shoving my face. I'll send it your way. Yeah, I know that's the photo you're hoping for, Paul.
And if the rabbi is there, he will take the picture with you. I promise you.
Wonderful. I'll tell him you sent me.
So Helen, let's talk. We're running out of time as I'm watching our timer. But in terms of other theaters you perform with, I mean, and working with PJ and this whole crew, I mean, it has got to be a very special experience for you with the intimacy of what you get to direct here.
Yeah, and also the company itself. You know, the space is intimate, but the company, they're very. They care about history. Obviously, they care about the mind, but they care about the mind through the heart. And they embody it in the way that they work and the people that they hire and how they interact with everyone that they hire. So it's a very special place to me because they do great art, but they do it with great heart. And that doesn't always happen.
And I got to tell you, I mean, when the show was coming, my first reaction, I don't mind saying this, was, you know, I've seen the show a couple of times, like, enough, I've seen it enough. And then I went, no, I'm going to go because it's Timeline. And I got to tell you, what a good decision that was on my part, because this particular production is just so engaging. I mean, I walked out and immediately went to Jay Kelly, your PR people. I said, oh, I got to do it now. I've got to talk to Beth. I've got to talk to Helen. We've got to do this because this is just such the set alone. It's like, this is just so much more realistic and so real. And the time that we're in, there's just so much more to talk about. And that's relevant today than even when Heidi wrote it. It's just amazing. And I thank you both for spending time with me. Let me let our listeners and viewers know that what the Constitution means to me plays at Timeline Theater over on the convenient Wellington Street, right in the neighborhood.
Give them your home address, Paul.
Go to the bagel beforehand and have a piece of gefilte fish and then walk on over and see the show. And the secret is, if you're from out of town, the bagel will actually let you keep your car there. Just make sure you let them know it's there. Not going to be happy I just said that. But the show is playing through July 2nd, and you can get tickets at timelinetheater.com. Theater spelled the proper British way, T-R-E, timelinetheater.com. Beth and Helen, thank you for spending time with me. I appreciate it. Break legs every night thank that the you, show continues
Paul,
to run.
Thank you so much.
It was so great.
Thank you so much for continuing the conversation with us and for bringing more eyeballs to and more people, hopefully, to the seats of this important show. So thank you, Paul, so much.
My honor. Thank you.
Thank you.